to Clinton UMC's online service. Happy Sunday.
Hello, I'm Faith Evers, Clinton's Children's Coordinator. We all had an awesome time at Kids Camp last week. I'd like to say a huge thank you to all the wonderful volunteers who helped out and to all the parents who shared your children with us.
Good morning. I have a couple of announcements. Our friends from the band Beyond the Walls will entertain us at a free outdoor concert Thursday, August 26th at 6:30 p.m. Join us at Riverside or indoor in case of rain for a great evening with friends and music. And we have a new mission, partnering with Eva's Village. It's a nonprofit organization that supports struggling families near Paterson, New Jersey. We'll be supplying children with back-to-school supplies. You may donate crayons, pencils, notebooks, binders, pens, paper, etc. Donations can be dropped off at our North Hunterdon Mission site during operating hours or in the bin at the ramp door of the church office. Thanks and be well.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord.
Friends, one of the gifts that we experience in worship is having this opportunity to pray with and for one another and pray for those who are in need. So in this time of a collective sharing of prayer time, I invite us to now join in this time of prayer. Let us pray. Our most gracious and generous God, we are gathered together in your name. By your grace, you're calling us into your holy presence as your children of faith. In this sacred time and space, we humbly open our hearts and lives unto you, O Lord. Lord, speak to us and cause us to respond to your word. Teach us and help us to uphold your statutes. Make us understand the way of your precepts. Your word is truth. It is a lamp to our feet, the light for our path. We treasure it in our hearts. And in your revered purpose, we find our strength and our purpose. We praise you, O Lord, for our church and for so many dedicated servants for the work of the gospel. Today, we are especially grateful for our responsible reentry team who has worked very hard and faithfully to guide the ministry of our church since March last year. We also give you thanks for all the loving volunteer leaders, youth assistant leaders, and staff for the kids' camp last week. Oh Lord, as the people of faith, we now take time to pray for those we love, those who are close, near and close to our hearts. To those who are carrying heavy burdens, oh Lord, help them put their burdens down at the foot of the cross and receive your renewing presence and gift of life. To those who have lost their loved ones, O Lord, comfort them and surround them with your words of assurance and hope. Those who are lonely, be their friend. And to those who are seeking the right path of life, be their good shepherd. Lord, open our eyes and hearts so that we can know and do your will for your glory. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now continue on and sharing the praying the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. There are two scripture readings for today. The first is from Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet who shall speak to them everything that I command. The second scripture is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 11. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Happy Sunday to you, my friends. Atheism is a non-profit organization. As a storm raged, the captain realized his ship was sinking very fast. So he shouted out, "Anyone here know how to pray?" Just one fellow stepped forward and said, "Yes, Captain, I know how to pray." "Good," said the captain. You pray while the rest of us put on our life jackets. We're one short. Well, friends, during this summer season, we've been reflecting on some of the popular questions that we have raised in relation to faith and life, Bible and application in life. So today's sermon is based on this question: what is the role of the prophets in the Bible? Now, this is a huge question, by the way, which calls for more than just one simple sermon. It probably needs two or three different series of sermons. But for just today, I'm inviting us to reflect on the prophets in the Bible based upon four-part question series here. So I'll raise those and we'll reflect on that. First question: who are the major prophets and minor prophets of the Bible? Now, friends, this is how I would describe or define the Bible. The Bible is simply a love letter from God, compiled into 66 books and written over a period of, say, 1,600 years by more than 40 authors living on three different continents. Although the authors came from different backgrounds, there is one message, one theme, one thread that runs throughout the entire Bible, from the first book of the Bible, Genesis, to the last book of the Bible, which is Revelation. That message is simply this: God's redeeming love for humankind. God's redeeming love for humankind. It is a message that is as relevant for us today as it was 2,000 years ago. Now, friends, we have the five books of the major prophets. You know who they are, some of you. But let me spell out for you. The five books, the major prophets: Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, and Daniel. They cover a significant time span and present a wide array of messages. For example, Isaiah spoke to the nation of Judah about 150 years before their exile into Babylon and called them to be faithful to God. Jeremiah cried out to those same people on the brink of that exile and pleaded for their repentance. Lamentations, also written by Jeremiah, presents a dirge as Judah went into exile. And the last two major prophets, that's Ezekiel and Daniel, spoke and wrote to the people in exile, encouraging them to remember that God was still in control and would eventually restore the spiritual fortunes of God's nation, God's chosen people. Well, it has been said that no other section of the Bible offers such a majestic and highly exalted picture or image of God. God's sovereignty is mind-boggling. God's glory is breathtaking. And in reading these books, our faith finds new depth of confidence and assurance. Get ready to meet this wonderful God of the prophecies, and to be amazed at the prophecies of God as they unfold in these first five prophetic books. Now, let's go to the minor prophets. The minor prophets are the following, actually 12 of them: Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Now, these minor prophets are also sometimes called the 12. So I go to the second question for our time together. So what is the difference between, say, the major prophets and the minor prophets? The only difference, actually, between the two is the number of pages written. Yeah, just the number of pages written. The minor prophets were not less important than the major prophets. They were just more concise. They saved more words. So less is more is what we can think about here. So that's the only difference the length of the pages that's written. So I go to the third question then. That is, who are the prophets anyway as found in the Bible? Now, friends, when you hear the phrase prophets, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? A fortune teller? Maybe. How about social critique? Commentators? Or a fire and brimstone preacher? Or a teller of the future? Prophets were chosen spokespersons by God, actually, and who delivered God's word in God's behalf. The term prophet has several meanings, to, say, proclaim, to bubble forth, or pour forth words. So I invite us to go back to the Old Testament reading for today, Deuteronomy 18 and verse 18, which says, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, shall speak to them everything that I command. From this passage, we can see that prophets are God's spokespersons or God's messengers. Remember the phrase, don't kill me, I'm just the messenger. Remember that phrase? They were called by God to speak to people an authoritative word. They were significant in what they said and what they were. Now, when we consider the divine revelations in the Bible, everything in the Bible is prophetic in some fashion. Through the prophets, God spoke. God spoke to us. Through the prophets, we learn much about the purpose and the plan of God. And through the prophets, God warned against the superstitious beliefs of idol worshipers or false gods. Throughout the prophets, God revealed that God is the Lord of history. So through the prophets, the Jewish nation understood their role in history as a chosen people. Now what does it mean to be God's people, chosen people? The prophets provide the answer, and through the prophets, the invisible God becomes more visible, even audible, being able to hear God's voice. So I'm going to go to the fourth question, which is the last question, and here it is. What is the role of the prophets? Well, 1 Corinthians 12, which is the other Bible passage that we read today, it tells us that prophecy is one of the vital works of the Holy Spirit, which include the ministries of wisdom, healing, and also discernment. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11 says this way, all these are activated by one and the same Spirit. Different forms of ministries and gatherings and so on, but all these things are activated by one and the same Spirit. So there is a sense of continuity, there is a clear sense of direction and purpose led by or inspired and nudged by the Holy Spirit. See, the prophets of Israel had three important functions as I reflect on this further. First, it's divinely appointed moral and ethical preachers and teachers. Secondly, conveyed the predictions of future events concerning the nation of Israel and the coming of the Messiah. Thirdly, it warned Israel against the dangers of religious apostasy. See, friends, the prophetic office came from God. Irrespective of previous training, in having to say no to society by challenging the nation and in condemning sin, they always held out hope for forgiveness and restoration, to reconcile the nation with God. Every prediction of disaster is a caring exhortation to repentance, which means making a total U-turn back to the Lord God. The call to prophecy was conveyed with a kind of miracle, the sign or vision from God. as with the call to pastoral ministry, there was an inner conviction and outward evidence which verified the divine call. Their role was to provide guidance for the leaders, just as some religious leaders today are in a position to provide a guidance and support and encouragement to those who govern. Someone once said to me this way, "You know, you'd need a pretty thick skin to want to be a prophet." Oh, that's a loaded statement, isn't it? You need a thick skin to be able to function as a prophet. Well, actually, as many of you know, prophets weren't known to win friends. Sometimes they are without friends. Theirs was a lonely profession. Many prophets were actually persecuted and or even killed. To confront people with the truth, regardless of the cost, takes a great deal of courage. But the prophet's worst occupational hazard was really seeing an unconcerned nation reject God's word and then witnessing the awful consequences. Sometimes we think being prophetic gives us an excuse to be mean-spirited, harsh, judgmental, argumentative, and downright nasty. Confrontation does not mean telling someone off. The Bible is clear that we are to speak the truth in love. With the exception of Jonah, all the prophets in the Bible here had compassion for the people to whom they were called to deliver bad news. Like the prophets, we are called to love even the unlovable today. God's word anticipates a response here. God wants to be the ruling force in our lives. So we need every aspect of our lives under our Lord's supervision and guidance. We live not for ourselves, but for God. That's an important distinction here. Yes, we live not for ourselves, but for God, in obedience to God's will and under God's care and guidance. The prophets called people to repent, make a U-turn, and go back to God. And these are the people who talk about God, talk about God's redeeming love for people, and who speak the truth with love. These are the people today we can dare to call God's chosen prophets. So you wonder, who are these people? Well, actually, can I say it's us, you and I? We are the ones who have been called by God to be the prophets for our generation. We share our faith because we are driven by the urgency of the message and the leading of the Holy Spirit. We tell others about Christ because we see this as our calling, our mission, yes. And we speak with confidence that God will be there for us, fully present with us, walking right next to us, guiding us, equipping us, and using us for the sake of the gospel's work. So, friends, we are blessed to have this opportunity to be the people who speak on behalf of our God in the name of God's compassion, justice, and love. So today, I invite all of us to take this challenge, this fresh challenge, into our own hearts and see where we can go with the Lord to make a difference, to proclaim the good news of our Lord for our generation today. So friends, let us go forth and spread God's redeeming love for all humanity by speaking the truth in love. So be it, Lord. Amen.
Hi, I'm Beth Crawford. I wonder if you know how important your gifts are to our church and how important our church is to sharing the good news of God's love with our community. If you've seen the video from Kids Camp last week, though, it gives you a little bit of an idea. How important it is for our children to know that God loves them and that God created this place and that God is with us. I want to thank you for your generous giving to God through Clinton UMC. Will you join me in praying for those gifts to be multiplied? Loving God, thank you for giving us so much more than we could ask or imagine. Right now, we dedicate the gifts we give back to you, and we humbly pray that you will multiply them and use them in a powerful way. Thank you, God. Amen.
Louder than the unbelief.
My good friends, I'm so glad we could come together as a worshiping community through this online service. So glad you could join us. And thank you so much for joining us, and invite you to come and join us again for a wonderful time of worshiping God. As we depart from this place, I offer you the words of blessing. May the peace of Christ be with you. May the great, awesome love of God enfold you, and may the encouragement and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit guide your path. May the good Lord keep you and bless you always. Go in God's peace. Amen.